Amen. Amen, church family. You guys can have a seat this morning. If you're a guest with us this morning, thank you for coming to Freedom Fellowship today. And God is doing great things, isn't He? He does great things. We worship a God who cares for us. We worship a God who knows us right where we are and knows the thoughts inside of our head. We worship a God who, even though the thoughts we have rolling through our heads are crazy sometimes, He loves us just the same. Amen. It's great things. You know, I was thinking about the last few weeks that we've had here at Freedom Fellowship, and this last week I was at a conference out in Colorado. It was a conference about evangelism and what it means, this great gospel that we've been given, and in a world that seems hectic and strife-ridden, that we have good news. That we have good news that we can share, and that we have a risen Savior. And, you know, when I was taking this time to just think through my church family, and the things that God has done here, it's just kind of crazy to me. We had Palm Sunday several weeks ago now, and we had 9 baptisms in Palm Sunday. And what a great thing, right? It's about the fact that God is alive and working in people's lives, and that they are making testimony that they are the Lord Jesus Christ. They have given themselves to Him. And then we had Easter Sunday the very next week, and it was just buzzing around here with a packed house. Then the next week we had a guest, Tim Brand from Many Hands, come. You guys remember that? Just a few weeks ago. Talking about what it means to be sent. And I hope that you feel that in your life. Wherever you are, that God has sent you there. And He has sent you to be an ambassador of His. And I was thinking about the things that are going to be unfolding with Many Hands coming here to Indianola, and what some of that ministry partnership looks like, and what a wonderful thing that God is doing, the great things that He does. And then after Tim Brand, the next week, we called with, which was just last week, Marcus Hendrickson. We called a youth director here to the church. We called him on, and that he'll be bearing some of the burden of ministry, and what that means to be growing in that way, to multiply ambassadors and ministers of the Lord Jesus Christ, because the harvest is plentiful, isn't it? I think what it means that Jesus walking with His disciples and looking out over Jerusalem and then looking to His disciples and said, "Hey guys, here's the thing. I've got a prayer request for you guys." Isn't that crazy? Jesus told the disciples, "I think I know what you should be praying for. Pray for laborers. Because the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few." And that's not just people that are called into full-time vocational ministry. It's just laborers. It's just people that identify so much with Jesus Christ and what He's done in their life, and the freedom and the salvation that they've found, and that comfort that transcends and surpasses all understanding, that we have the opportunity to share it. It's just a wonderful, beautiful thing. And then this week, we have a new parking lot. It's like another parking lot expansion. It's the second one that we've had in the last year and a half or so. And it's just like, what? The good things that God is doing, the great things that He does. If I could just think back over the last 6 weeks and say, man, we've got something happening every single week that's just amazing. And I would encourage you guys this. I hope that you're praying for your church. Keep praying for your church. We want to know and do what the Lord would have us to do. We have more things ahead of us. You know, we'll be expanding the kids' ministry downstairs. You know, half of the basement. Some of you guys are like, basement? Never been to the basement. We should go down there sometime. Half of it is remodeled for student ministry and kids ministry, and we have the other half that still needs to be done, and so we're going to be doing that. We have bathrooms that need some upgrades. We've got a sanctuary expansion possibility that we need to be thinking about. And then we've got this property. I remember months ago, Pastor Jeff talking about this property over here, this house that is sitting here, and we've got the opportunity maybe to step into that property and to purchase that property. And so we're praying about it. We're thinking about it. We're asking the Lord for direction. Sometimes we live our Christian life as though it's just a small component of our life, and that and we just get up every morning and we just go through routines. But here's the thing. We need direction from Jesus Christ Himself. That sounds kind of crazy. It's real. And without it, you'll find yourself in a heap of mess. So we want to make the right moves. We want to make the right calls. And I ask you to be praying for your church. We're going to jump into Matthew today. And before we jump into Matthew, I just want to pray and thank the Lord for the great things. You guys want to join me with that? Lord Jesus, thank You so much for the great things that You've done. We thank God that you have called us into a faith family, that you have called us to be representative ambassadors to the greatest gospel that the world has ever heard. People sit around wondering, maybe there's a God. I don't know if there's a God. Lord Jesus, would they find you? Would they see you? Would they see you in us? Lord, as we step into the things here at Freedom Fellowship and the things that you would have us to do as a church, would we be found faithful? And would we join the laborers, Lord, that exist right now all around our city, our state, our nation, and world, that we would be one, Lord Jesus, as you are one. God, send workers. The harvest is plentiful, Lord. We look around us, and Father, just in this last week, I sit in an airport watching people wander back and forth, and Father, they're hurting. You've given us good news, Lord. Thank you. Thank you that we can gather with the faith family. Thank you we can jump into your Gospel of Matthew today, Lord. I pray you would speak in power and authority that you would teach us, Lord. And we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. We're going to be spending several weeks in this series that we're calling The Gospel According to Matthew. The Gospel According to Matthew. You know, if you go into the New Testament, there are four books in the New Testament: Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And what do we call those books? They are the Gospels. And some people hear us talk about the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and they think there are four Gospels. Well, there are four records of the Gospel, but there's only one Gospel, isn't there? There's only one Gospel, and there were these four different individuals who made personal testimony of witnesses to the account of the Lord Jesus Christ walking on planet Earth. And so we, as a faith family, are going to be in the book of Matthew for a little while. And you might say, well, Pastor Ben, why Matthew? I can't tell you definitively why I landed on Matthew. But I can tell you, I was having a conversation with my brother, Joe. I have several brothers and a sister. And I was talking with my brother, Joe, a while back. This was probably 6 months ago. And he was saying, you know, he's been growing in his Christian faith a lot. Praise God. And he says, you know, sometimes I'm in Bible studies or I'm going to a church, and he's in the military, he travels quite a bit, and he'll visit different churches when he's traveling. And they'll be talking about something, and they'll be going to these really deep things, and we're going to get into some deep things, because today we're going to be going through the genealogy of Jesus. When we get to Matthew chapter 1, verse 1, we're going to be starting there. He says that sometimes I get into these deep things, and I just feel kind of overwhelmed, and I feel kind of like I don't know as much about the Bible as I should, and I feel kind of down about it, and I feel embarrassed, and he says, you know, sometimes when I don't know exactly what the Bible is saying to me, I'll just turn to one of the Gospels, and I'll just start reading it. And it hit me as a guy who's been walking with Christ for a while, who's studied the Bible quite a bit, and who has a whole lot to learn about the Bible still. It just impressed on me the powerful authority that exists inside of the Gospels. When we look at our Christian faith, we could say that Jesus Christ is the center of the Christian faith. And for my brother, he's realized that, you know, when everything else can be a little bit confusing, and I don't really know what I ought to think concerning all of the things inside of the Bible, that I can turn to Matthew, Mark, Luke, or John, and I can just pick it up and start reading, and what will happen is you will find yourself recentering on Jesus Christ and his authority. So we're going to spend some time in Matthew. And we're going to be talking about genealogy. I think it's kind of funny. About 15 to 17 years ago, I was in youth ministry, and I had this group of youth pastors that I was aware of. They were a network that I wasn't actually connected with. But what they were doing is they would meet together regularly. They would pray together. And one of my friends had a friend in that group that was a youth pastor. One of the things that he would do is he would get groups together, and he would take groups overseas, and he would do missions things. And so he kind of did youth missions things. Pretty cool. One of his trips, he went to Poland. And on his trip to Poland, he brought his wife with him, and they were over, you know, kind of doing some ministry work in Poland. And he thought it would be fun to take his wife and to go into this town. And the town that they went to was called Zeri, Poland. Guy's name is Richard Dietrich. He was in, actually at that point he was living in Arizona, I think. Kind of stuff, and my buddy knew him from out there in Arizona. And he's visiting Poland with his wife, and he says his wife's family history. We're gonna be looking at family history and backgrounds and lineage. His family history, her side of the family, was from Poland. And so, as they talked, she thought that her family was from this place, Zary, Poland. So they go into a library there, I believe, and they were starting to talk to some of the people in the town about her family background. And as he's talking to this clerk at this counter, saying that they were trying to find some background to her family, this lady says, "That can't be true." He's like, "What do you mean?" She says, your maiden name is Prominz. He says, "Yeah, from Von Prominz." She says, that can't be true. And she runs off and grabs her boss, who comes forward as they're wanting to do this lineage, background, family history. And as they discuss, they find out that her family is a direct lineage and descendant of royalty. That Poland thought they had lost all their royals, and this youth pastor had married a royal. They said, "This can't be true." And as they're talking, they said, "We just sold your family castle to a development agency like 2 months ago. You know, we're sorry we sold your castle." The family had moved 300 years earlier and had found out they'd fled during the 30 Years' War, 1613 to 1646. And the whole idea here is this. It didn't matter how far removed they were from that royalty. They were still royal. They brought them back into the royal family and back into Poland, and it's just been an amazing thing. And my buddy, as I kind of lived vicariously hearing what was going on through the situation through my friend who was friends with this guy, he became a royal. And I think that it's so funny. It's like a movie. I mean, there should be a movie about this. And literally, they're on this trip, this ministry trip, and they actually haven't reclaimed all of their castles and stuff like that. They've just been living as royalty and kind of actually continuing to do ministry and do ministry through music. But this message isn't about them. It's about this. They were reinstated into royalty, and just because they didn't know it didn't mean they weren't royal. Friends, we've been adopted by blood, haven't we? Christians are royal. And we need to remember that when we jump into this book of Matthew. Matthew is written primarily to Jews. And you might wonder, well, because the other books have other, you know, Matthew, Mark is written about the immediacy. He's written to the Romans. Luke writes in this linear way, first this, then this, then this. And he just wants to do it in his timeline. John wants to fill in all the gaps of the other things that weren't yet discussed about Jesus' life and the other Gospels. And so we say, "Pastor Ben, why would we jump into Matthew? It's primarily written to the Jews." And I think, perfect for 21st century Americans. Like, this is going to be perfect. I mean, why would a book written to the Jews be perfect for the 21st century Americans? The purpose is to show Jesus as the prophesied Messiah. As we go through this book, you're going to see things often mentioned, prophecy, just as the prophet so-and-so said. And you're going to go, "I don't know that prophet, and I don't know what he was talking about, and I don't know." And I'm going to encourage you, look back. Figure out, make the connections, tie it together, and I'm going to get to some of the points of why we're going to want to do that here in a minute. The author is Matthew, and how many of you guys have seen The Chosen, have gone through The Chosen series, many of you? In The Chosen series, Matthew is kind of like seen as this autistic individual, and he's always like thinking about numbers and stuff like that. I've just cautioned you that that's not biblical. We don't know that he was this autistic kind of guy, but it's fun to see personality given to him, right? That's not absolutely biblical, but he was a tax collector. And the tax collectors were part of the Roman state, really. They had given up their history and their lineage, and they'd really associated themselves to the Romans, and what they did is they collected taxes, right? And so they would collect taxes from whom? Well, specifically the Jews, in this case, the people in that province. And so he had left, and in the Jewish culture and context, to separate yourself, in essence, from family, and to associate yourself with this pagan, foreign country, and then to be the one that collects taxes from your family and from your brothers and from your sisters to give to the Roman state, you're seen as a traitor, an outcast, a turncoat. This is Matthew. This is the one whom we read about. we look over this book, a quick outline is us like kind of looking forward. If you wonder where we're going with this, the intro of the book of Matthew is what we'll be jumping into here. You get Jesus' family tree. And then the book of Matthew is really organized over five different discourses from the Lord Jesus Christ, or you could use the word teachings. Five different times in the book of Matthew, Jesus just starts out on this teaching. He lays all this amazing teaching down, and then in between his teachings in the book, what you get is ministry happening. So he teaches a bunch of stuff, and then you have ministry rollout. And he teaches a bunch of stuff, and then you have ministry rollout. And that's kind of the ebb and flow of it. And then at the end of the book, you get the Great Commission, where he tells all of his disciples, he says that we are on a co-mission. We are doing this together. I'm going to use you. And you know what he even uses? Tax collectors, sinners of all kinds. Let's jump into Matthew chapter 1 now. And we'll just read down through the first six verses. It says this: the genealogy of Jesus the Messiah is how mine titles this section. Verse 1, the record of the genealogy of Jesus, the Messiah, the son of David, the son of Abraham. I'm going to kind of read the phone book for a second. I was telling somebody it's like reading the phone book when you read these genealogies. Abraham was the father of Isaac, and Isaac the father of Jacob. Jacob the father of Judah and his brothers. Judah was the father of Perez and Zerah by Tamar. Perez was the father of Hezron, and Hezron the father of Ram. Ram was the father of Abinadab, and Abinadab the father of Nahshon. Nahshon the father of Solomon. Solomon the father of Boaz by Rahab. Boaz was the father of Obed by Ruth, and Obed the father of Jesse. Jesse was the father of David the king. David was the father of Solomon by Bathsheba, who had been the wife of Uriah. Let's just kind of pause there. I think the first point for today, if you're like, man, what a crazy long intro, what's the point, Pastor Ben? The first point is this: Jesus is history's highest. Jesus Christ is history's highest, anointed, royal, God's promise fulfilled. When I think about, again, this doesn't maybe seem like an like earth-shattering point. Jesus is history's highest. We're Christians and we gather here. But I want to present to you the biggest question in the history of the world is this: who is Jesus Christ? Because if salvation hinges on him, the answer to that question is profound. And I'm grieved today because Americans look at Jesus Christ as this Western religious idea. Do you think that Jesus Christ is just the beginner of an American religion? That Jesus Christ is maybe this model teacher? See, we dumb it way down. We don't think Jesus is history's highest. We think, oh, well, he was a good teacher a long time ago. He was like American religion. He was not a historical person. He's kind of mystical because his mother was a virgin, and so his family line must be kind of perfect because, like, who's born of a virgin? That doesn't happen very often, like never, right? So we think about him as being this mystical, magic, maybe he existed, maybe he didn't. It's pretty obvious that he started a Western religion, and the Western cultures have been influenced by him, and so this is who Jesus Christ is. Wrong. Dead wrong. He is so much more than that. He is history's highest. You guys ever play King of the Hill out in school? King of the Hill? When I was growing up, I went to Irving Elementary School. And for anybody that has been at Irving Elementary School lately, it's changed a lot since the day that I was at Irving. Irving used to have this big slide. It was like known for the big slide. Well, to have a big slide, you have a big hill. And I remember during recesses playing up on that hill, King of the Hill, and whoever was on top was king, right? Whoever had the greatest strength and could exert himself and his force, throwing everyone down, he was king. I want you to see Jesus Christ as history's highest. In his grace, he hasn't exerted all of his muscle and strength on us to flatten us and throw us tumbling down Irving's big hill. He's history's highest. In everyone who's ever existed in the history of the planet, Jesus Christ stands king of the hill, up on top. He's not a Western religious figure. It's ridiculous and preposterous to put it that way. He is so much more. And so when I exhort you, and as brothers and sisters in Christ, to give your life to Him, what I'm exhorting you to is to give your life to history's highest. There is none greater. No one has walked the earth with more influence. There are more books written about Him, more songs written to Him, more poetry written about Him, more buildings dedicated to Him than anyone else in the history of the world. Amen? He is history's highest. We stand in His lineage. We are His descendants. This verse 1 says the record of the genealogy of Jesus, the Messiah. Messiah, again, this being written to a Jewish audience, is not a word that we're really familiar with. It means anointed, which is probably another word that we're not terribly familiar with. But anointed simply means from God. If you're looking for just a simple definition, from God. He is the expected Savior that they were waiting for, this Messiah, this anointed one, this one sent from God as God's gift to us. God sent us a gift, Jesus Christ, history's highest. Not an American fad. And Jesus had a family history. He didn't come from nowhere. He isn't this great mystic. He has a lineage. He has a family history. And as we think about, we talked weeks and weeks ago about the hypostatic union, truly God and truly man. This is the truly man side. It's like, well, did he have a father? Well, he was born of a virgin, so he had a heavenly father. But he also had a father, right? Joseph. Joseph would be kind of like his adopted dad. And he had all of these people, part of which we read just now. He's the Messiah. He's from God. Also, he is titled Son of David. This puts him in direct lineage of royalty. Jesus Christ was royal. If you want to look at the literal history of who he was, again, this is, seems so conceptual because people look at Jesus as this ultimate maybe. He wasn't a maybe. He had a family history. You want to look at his family lineage? We got it. You want to look at his relatives and his sisters and brothers and background? We got it. Here in America, we forget how much overseas geography that there is that bears witness and testimony of this people group called the Jewish nation and the Jewish people. And so when we read through this list, we think, well, I don't really know any of those guys. Well, you don't have to know them. But you can read about them and study them and go to where they were born and go to the wells that they drew water from and go to the fields where they had flocks and pastures and go to the battlefields where they shed their blood. These people are real, friends. And Jesus Christ came from a lineage. He's the son of David. 2 Samuel 7:16 says this, "Your house and your kingdom shall endure before me forever. Your throne shall be established forever." This is Jesus, son of David. God gave David a promise. His lineage would endure and that he would rule forever. He's royalty. We could get all hijacked on the whole background of David, the mere shepherd boy, watching an army trembling in their boots because of a giant. You recall the story? He comes to bring food and some items to his brothers, and he watches this cowering army before an almighty giant. Small shepherd boy says, "Who is this uncircumcised Philistine to stand before the armies of the living God?" It's like, what? So he overthrows the giant, doesn't he? And he becomes a king. And he becomes a historical king. And he becomes a king that bears lineage. It's interesting, in the text that we read, it mentions Bathsheba by name. This is another thing we won't get all the way into today. There's multiple women listed in this lineage, which is very unique. Because in other lineages, and especially in ancient cultures, you do not get the women. It's like, so-and-so begat so-and-so, so-and-so begat so-and-so. So-and-so. And you're like, how did they begat anybody? I think there was a woman in there somewhere. This lineage bears testimony to some of the women. Bathsheba. And it even mentions her husband Uriah, who was murdered on a battle line because of a sin of David. We won't go into all of it, but what I want you guys to know, I want you guys to start to expand your mind to the possibilities that just because you don't know everything about the Bible, and either do I, there are greater literal physical facts that happen here. And this faith of ours does take faith. There are times where we need to just cast all aside and we put our faith and trust in Christ. Why do the things happen in our life that happen? We don't know, but we trust that there's a God who's big. Why do we trust it? Because we see testimony of Him everywhere. And so we believe. He was the son of Abraham. This is God's promise fulfilled. Son of Abraham. This burdens me that these names are like names that we kind of understand. Like, oh yeah, I've heard of Abraham. But I know nothing about him. Genesis chapter 12, verse 1, God has this thing called the Abrahamic covenant, where God makes a promise. Can I tell you guys this, that when God makes promises, we should believe him? If God made a promise to this guy, Abraham, he'd say, man, I don't know Abraham, and I don't have this Jewish lineage, and I'm not really a part of this. I'm going to say, when God speaks, we need to pay attention. And there's this man, Abraham, and it's God's promise fulfilled. And in Genesis chapter 12, God starts talking to him, and it says, now the Lord said to Abram, go from your country and from your relatives and from your father's house. Pause there. Some of you guys are like, yes, I get to leave my family, and I get to go somewhere else. Because family can be crazy, right? Others would be like, oh, I don't want to leave my family. Well, I'll tell you this about leaving your family. When you're going to a place you've never been before, it takes faith to go somewhere you've never gone before. He says, to the land which I will show you. Remember when I was saying that we need to be praying for the direction of our church and for the... God will show us. We trust him in it. Verse 2, it says, and I will make you a great nation. God promises this man who no one knows, who's a great nobody at that point, God says, I'm going to make you into a great nation. I will bless you. I will make your name great. I think it's funny because many people don't really know much about Abraham today, but they know the name, don't they?
Who's this guy? Yeah, I don't know, Old Testament, old-fashioned guy.
God's made his name great that 4,000 years later, people still know who he is. So you shall be a blessing, God says, and I will bless those who bless you, and I will curse those who curse you. And in you, all the families of the earth will be blessed. Abrahamic blessing. Jesus is history's highest. He's anointed. He's royal. And he's God's promise fulfilled. Have you ever doubted God's promises? God maybe told, you're reading and you're seeing what God is saying. You're saying, God, I doubt it. I just don't know it. I just don't see it. I just don't know how it'll come to fruition. And here's the thing. They waited 2,000 years for Jesus to show up from that promise and the Abrahamic covenant. God's timelines aren't our timelines. And he will do what he will do. But we should trust him. His promises are fulfilled. He does it every time. What else do we find in these names? If we look through, we continue Matthew chapter 1, verse 2. You see, Abraham was the father of Isaac, and Isaac the father of Jacob. It goes on, Matthew chapter 1, verse 5. Mentions the name Rahab. The next point for today is this. History's highest had a flawed family. History's highest had a flawed family. So often when we talk about the Bible, people say, well, the Bible is just, you know, full of errors and contradictions. And it was also just a bunch of smart people who sat down and just kind of wrote a bunch of things out to create this religion and this idea of this mythology of God. If you were going to do that, if you were going to create a religion and you were going to try to deceive people for generations and generations and generations, why would you take your central figure from which your entire belief system hinges and then load that person's genealogy with all kinds of crooks and criminals and crooked kings? Don't you think that would discredit what it is that you were trying to do? Wouldn't you just conveniently leave those people out of the story? Why are they included? They're included because it's real. They're included because history's highest had a flawed family. They're included because he had a lineage. That's why they're included. easy for us to think because Jesus was Jesus that he just had this perfect family and that he just somehow like descended out of heaven and then he taught some cool things and then he just disappeared and then the story just continues. He's not mystic. He has a genealogy. It's not important all the time to American culture what the genealogy is, but it's important to the Jews and it should be important to us. And what's interesting about this flawed family is that the first couple of people that they mention here in verse 2, Abram was the father of Isaac, Isaac the father of Jacob. Have you guys heard about the blessing of the firstborn? So generally what happens in ancient cultures is the firstborn male is the recipient of all of the father's inheritance, right? And the firstborn son distributes that to all of the other kids. This is the idea historically of what's happened with the Jews forever. And not just the Jews, but in lots of cultures practice this. So the authority, the weight, sat on the firstborn. Isaac wasn't a firstborn. Jacob wasn't a firstborn. Have you ever thought about that? The blessing of this lineage and the blessing of God over this family isn't always attached to birth order. It's blessing over birth order. That's not going to be on the screen, but you can write that down. God's blessing over birth order. Neither Isaac nor Jacob were firstborn. I could go through some of the story of some of this, and I'm not going to today. I had some notes here, but we'll keep moving. But I want you to see this living and active God is choosing people that for his blessing to go down through. He gets to choose it. And when we just look at the Bible again, we're like, it's just a bunch of old-fashioned fairy tales and folklore and traditions. It's like, well, the tradition would have been that it would go through the firstborn. Why didn't it? Right? That's the tradition. God just wants us to understand his story. He's not bound by tradition. He gets to do what he wants. And so we read through it, this historic text that's thousands of years old, and we see God's blessing going from generation to generation, working through these people, Isaac and Jacob, cultures, criminals, and crooked kings. You can write that down. Cultures, criminals, and crooked kings. This is part of Jesus' family history. Rahab is mentioned in verse 5, what we're looking at today. You can find her story in Joshua chapter 2. Rahab was a Canaanite prostitute. Again, you look at the Old Testament and you say, oh, the Old Testament's so bigoted and it's racist because they had people killing other people groups and all this stuff. And yet God, in his sovereignty, points to this Canaanite, who's a foreigner, prostitute, and says, I'm going to use you to great end and I'll include you in the genealogy of Jesus Christ, the Savior and Lord. Have you counted yourself out because of your background in history? Have you counted yourself out because, well, I've never really done much? Like a small shepherd boy that nobody knew the name? Remember when they mocked him? Why don't you go back to your small herd? You're a nobody. Jesus Christ uses nobodies all the time. Ruth, in the book of Ruth, is mentioned in our text in verse 5 as well. A Moabite. Back when we were going, some time ago, we were going through Nehemiah and we realized that the Moabites weren't even allowed to go into the temple. They were in foreign land, a foreign country with foreign gods. Yet our great God used different cultures and folds them in on his history, on history's highest. Manasseh, the crooked king, I wanted to just read something that I saw in Manasseh that just makes your stomach turn. 2 Kings 21, we'll read verses 2 and 3 and then 5 through 6. This is talking about Manasseh. Jesus is one of the forebears of the family lineage of Jesus, Manasseh. Verse 2 says, he did evil in the eyes of the Lord. And to say, if your name was recorded in the Bible, you do not want to be known as that. He did evil in the eyes of the Lord, following the detestable practices of the nations that the Lord had driven out before the Israelites. Why was God so harsh with these other countries and cultures? They did detestable things. He says, I have a way that a person should live. My way is right, and these are wrong. They worship in pagan foreign gods. They're doing terrible, detestable things. You're going to hear about some of them in just a second. Verse 3, it says, he rebuilt the high places his father Hezekiah had destroyed. He took what his forefathers who were living rightly, he tore their works down and erected new high places. He erected altars to Baal and made an Asherah pole, as Ahab, the king of Israel, had done. Was Ahab a good guy or a bad guy? Bad guy. And yet Manasseh says, I'll do what Ahab did. Manasseh bowed down to all the starry hosts and worshiped them. Do people worship astrology today? They do. That's not a new thing. That's an old thing. They've been doing that for a long time. And here God condemns it. Unequivocally. Verse 5, it says, in the two courts of the temple of the Lord, he built altars to all the starry hosts. So he took God's place of worship and he converted it into a pagan worship place. Sacrificed his own son in the fire. Jesus' family history and his lineage was a guy who sacrificed his own son. Practiced divination, he sought omens, he consulted mediums and spiritists. He did much evil in the eyes of the Lord, arousing his anger. Is there anything in your family history that keeps you from following Christ? Let's move on quickly. Jesus is history's highest. History's highest had a flawed family. History's highest called six sinners to himself. History's highest called six sinners to himself. We're going to go, I'm going to encourage you to flip forward to Matthew chapter 9. Matthew chapter 9. We're going to read verses 9 through 12, because I wanted in this first message, I wanted to introduce you to Matthew. This is where Matthew gets called. Jesus is walking the earth. Jesus is calling different people to follow him. And in Matthew chapter 9, it says this, Matthew 9, verse 9. As Jesus went on from there, he saw a man called Matthew sitting in the tax collector's booth. He said to him, follow me. I'm just going to encourage you guys, if you like underlining things in your Bible, if anything ever jumps out to you, underline it. If you don't like writing in your Bible, then have a notebook and take notes. Here's Matthew sitting in the tax collector's booth, and he said, follow me. And he got up and he followed him. And then it happened that as Jesus was reclining at the table in the house, behold, many tax collectors and sinners were dining with Jesus and his disciples. When the Pharisees saw this, they said to his disciples, why is your teacher eating with tax collectors and sinners? Friends, this is history's highest. Did he only make company with other kings and royalty? Company with tax collectors and sinners. When Jesus heard this, he said, it's not those who are healthy who need a physician. Those who are sick. He says, go and learn what this means. I desire compassion and not sacrifice. I did not come to call the righteous, but sinners. History's highest called six sinners to himself. When you look at Jesus' background in history, and you look at how he called Matthew, Jesus sees you. I was writing this point, sitting in another state, scribbling stuff out, typing, and I thought to myself, I wonder how many times in ministry, I wonder how many times in my life I will exhort people to this truth. Jesus sees you. Matthew 9:9. He went on from there, he saw a man. Jesus sees you. He sees what you go through. He sees your hardships. He sees your heartache. He sees your joys. He sees your victories. He sees you. And yet, and I would write that down. I know that's not on the screen. It was kind of a sub-main point here. Jesus sees you at your worst. You know, if royalty came into the room, or if you were going to have a great guest come to your house, you would prepare, would you not? You'd clean up the house. You'd make the bed, you know, even though they're not going in your bedroom. You'd clean the bathroom all up. And you'd want them to see you at your best. And so when we come to church, we polish up a little bit, and we want people to see us at our best. And that makes great sense. But can I tell you this? Jesus sees you at your worst. Jesus comes strolling through town. He sees the man sitting in a tax collector's booth. It's like busted. You ever have your kids doing something? Just yesterday, my kids were in the backyard throwing a football around. And I stand in the kitchen. I'm looking over. My wife's sitting there by the window looking out like this. None of you moms, none of you guys have never spied on your kids, have you?
Never.
Not even a thing. She's spying on the kids. And they're arguing about something. So she cracks the window and she can holler right out to them, you know? History's highest sees us at our worst. He sees it all. Can't even imagine Matthew's feeling when this guy who people are saying is the Messiah, the promised one of Israel, history's highest, the king of the hill, and he comes walking through and he looks over and he sees this betraying, desperate Jew sitting in this tax collector's booth, taking and robbing wages from everyone around him that are his countrymen. He sees Jesus' gaze as Jesus sees him, and he calls him by name. Friends, does he condemn him? Just follow me. Just follow me. He didn't berate him. He didn't tell him four things that he needed to do right now. It wasn't 10 things to a better life. It was nothing like that, was it? This is the most simple message on planet Earth, but it would demand a change in everything around him. Follow me. You know what Matthew wrote in his account and what every other gospel writer wrote? He did. He did. As the worship team comes up, we get ready to wrap up the message for today. Jesus calls you to follow him. History's highest. He understands what a flawed family is all about. You say, but Pastor Ben, I've done all these terrible things. You say, Pastor Ben, I haven't even done it right yet. Like, I feel like I still don't know what I'm doing. That's cool, man. You have room. There's room in Jesus' family for that. It could be no simpler than follow me. No big speech, no sermon, no convincing, no selling it. We get the opportunity to follow Jesus all of our days. How many days will that be, Pastor Ben? I have no idea. But to live is Christ, amen? And to die is gain. When we do die, when that fateful day comes, we will see our Master face to face. History's highest will be no more real to us than the day when we see him face to face. And our faith becomes sight, the scripture says. And we will know him. And he will call us by name. It will be a glorious day. Jesus calls us to follow him. Let's praise him in song. But before we do that, let's pray to him and honor him for who he is. Lord Jesus, we jump into the beginning of this book, Matthew. And it's confounding to us, Lord God. And I will confess to you how difficult it was to staring at this text and thinking, preach the phone book. Jesus, you are so good. You are history's highest. You see us where we're at. You see us in our worst. And you call us all the same. Lord, if there is anyone here who hasn't given their life to you, I pray that they would. I pray that they would recognize that they don't know what to do with their life. That they would just own up to that. That they have all these questions and doubts and concerns and fears. And that their foundation and their feet would be girded up because they would give all of that to you. They would confess their sin. They would turn from it and follow you with their lives. History's highest, we honor you and we honor you. Even with meager song today. But we will sing it with all we've got because we love you, Lord. And you've changed us from the inside out. Carry us to this place in your grace. In Jesus' name we pray.